They were some of history's most consequential road trips, and they started right here in our backyard in Kent, Washington. I'm Sarah Martin. I'm a consulting historian specializing in architectural history and the built environment. A recent project took me well beyond the walls of a building. In following the paths of these historic road trips, I've journeyed from Kent all the way to the moon. So let's begin in July 1969, when Neil Armstrong took that giant leap onto the lunar surface. With that Apollo 11 mission, the United States had achieved John F. Kennedy's challenge of landing a man on the moon and returning him to Earth. NASA's focus now turned from getting to the moon to exploring it. For the first three moon landings, astronauts were limited to exploring the lunar surface on their own 2 feet. They didn't get very far. The astronauts on Apollo 14 walked the farthest, but even their combined distance was only 2.2 miles. That's less than a walk around Seattle's Green Lake. Think about it. They traveled all that way and only experienced a tiny part of the moon. If NASA hoped to do more, it knew it needed a vehicle that could take astronauts farther and return them safely. It turned to Boeing, specifically the company's aerospace division, which was based in its new $20 million space center in Kent. And this was private industry's most advanced space research facility. And it was part of a rapidly changing Green River Valley in South King County, an area that had long been a center of agriculture, but now, with improving infrastructure, welcomed business and industry. NASA had ambitious goals for the vehicle. It had to be lightweight, because even with the most powerful rocket ever made carrying Apollo missions into space, every pound mattered. But it also had to be able to carry hundreds of pounds of lunar samples and equipment. It had to be big enough to carry two astronauts in full spacesuits, plus all their gear, their tools, the moon rocks they picked up, but small enough to fit inside one of the lunar lander's storage bays. And it had to be reliable, because a breakdown could spell disaster for the astronauts and the entire Apollo program. The team at Boeing got to work on what would become the lunar roving vehicle. They designed, tested, and built the first of three flight vehicles in just 17 months, and they were 6 weeks ahead of schedule. The vehicle had an aluminum frame with wire mesh wheels designed specifically to maneuver the fine-grained lunar surface. It measured just over 10 feet long and 6 feet wide. It had two batteries that powered the vehicle, and it averaged a speed of between 5 and 10 miles per hour. Now, to get to the moon, and this is my favorite part, it was folded into thirds and carried in a storage bay of the lunar lander. It was spring-loaded, so when the astronauts were ready to use the rover, all they had to do while standing on the moon was pull a tether, and voila, the rover unfolded onto the moon's surface. I'm simplifying, of course, but it only took about 15 minutes. Even though NASA mission rules prevented astronauts from traveling farther from the landing site than they could walk back, and that was in the event of a breakdown, the rovers performed almost flawlessly. They enabled astronauts on Apollo 15, 16, and 17 to collectively travel more than 10 times the distance covered on Apollo 11, 12, and 14, clocking a total of more than 50 miles on their odometers. What Boeing created not only was the pride of NASA, it was the pride of Kent. The Kent News Journal sent a pair of reporters to Florida, a husband-wife team, to cover the Apollo 15 launch in July 1971. Their dispatches and the paper's other rover highlights are a wonderful window into the excitement of Kent during this time. Mayor Isabel Hogan, the city's first female mayor, proudly promoted Kent's role in building the rover. She even tried to convince NASA twice to put a Kent-themed decal on the rover's fender, what could have been the first bumper sticker in space, but she was unsuccessful. The local JCs made rover-themed buttons as a fundraiser, which went on sale just in time for the Apollo 15 astronauts' visit to Kent following their journey. Even the annual parade featured a local youth driving a tinfoil rover replica on the parade float. So perhaps more than any other Space Center project, the rover captured the interest and imagination of the Kent community. All of this was happening, though, in the early 1970s, as the rising unemployment of the Boeing bust had gripped the Puget Sound region. One wonders if the rovers would have been even more celebrated during better economic times. Today, nearly 50 years after these historic road trips, the three rovers still sit where the astronauts parked them, on the visible side of the moon some 239,000 miles away. Last year, the city of Kent launched a campaign to celebrate the city's special place in space history, a campaign for which King County presented the city an award. As part of the campaign, the city tracked down former Boeing employees who worked on the rover project and recorded their memories. These men, who were assigned to everything from design and testing to quality assurance, they still have so much pride in the work they did as a team. The city also successfully designated the three rovers as community landmarks and has applied for their designation to the Washington Heritage Register. These honorary designations are trailblazing in Washington state, but they won't stand entirely alone. In 2010, California and New Mexico included in their respective state registers a group of lunar objects at the Apollo 11 landing site. Meanwhile, as the 50th anniversaries of the rover road trips draw closer, a new chapter of space history is being written in Kent. NASA recently chose Kent-based Blue Origin to build a lunar lander for the agency's Artemis program, a successor to the Apollo program. It will land the first woman and the next man on the moon by 2024. So with any luck, we'll be back soon to see how those remarkable vehicles have weathered and maybe even take them for another drive.